The first intermolecular force we're going to talk about is ionic. And we've been talking about ionic compounds since the first of the semester. And really, the ionic intermolecular force is that electrostatic attraction between cations and anions and ionic compounds. So we know salts or ionic compounds tend to break into positively and negatively charged species, and that positive and negatively charged things tend to interact with each other. That's what we're talking about here. That's our ionic intermolecular force. So if I want to understand, does something have an ionic molecular force? Does a specific substance have an ionic intermolecular force? Really, the question is the substance an ionic compound? And remember, we decided that is a metal bonded to a nonmetal. And so metal and nonmetal, that refers to different parts of the periodic table. So overall, when we're done, we have four intermolecular forces. We're going to be comparing all four of those. But with some of the intermolecular forces, we are actually able to compare the strength of the ionic intermolecular force in one compound and the ionic intermolecular force in a different compound. And that's what we want to take a second and look at. So in general, ionic intermolecular forces increase as the charges on the ions increase inside of the ionic compound. So when we look at it, and I ask you a question, well, which one would I expect to have a higher melting point, magnesium oxide or sodium chloride? Here, the first thing I want to do is make sure these are both ionic compounds. So I understand, you know, metal bonded to a nonmetal. So both of these species have ionic intermolecular forces. But now I want to compare the two. And how I do that is by looking at the charges of the species inside of there. So I say, what's the charge on magnesium? What's the charge on oxygen? When I do that, I realize that magnesium oxide has a +2 and a -2 ionic charge inside of there. So magnesium 2+, oxygen 2-. Sodium chloride has a +1 and a -1 charge. So sodium plus, Cl minus. Between these two, a +2 and a -2 interaction is going to be stronger than a +1 and a -1 interaction. So I can tell the difference between these two ionic compounds by looking at the charges of the species inside of there. So of these two, I would expect magnesium oxide to have the higher melting point. And when I go and I look it up, yeah, that's right. So magnesium oxide has a melting point of 2852 degrees C, where sodium chloride only has a melting point of 108 degrees C. Another way that we can tell the difference between two substances that have an ionic intermolecular force is by looking at the ionic radius of some of the ions inside of there. The overall rule is that as a positive and negative charge comes closer together, they have a stronger attraction. So this comes into as the atomic or the ionic radii of the ions inside of my compound become smaller, that tends to increase the intermolecular force. So if I have two different species, both with intermolecular forces, the one with the smaller ionic radii is going to have the stronger intermolecular force. So I want to go in there and look at the ionic radius of the ions that are inside of there, and I can do a direct comparison. So we've already talked about the periodic trend for ionic radius or atomic radius. This tends to increase as we go to the left and down on the periodic table. But remember, really what we're interested in is what increases the strength of our intermolecular force. So we want smaller ionic radii. So really the ionic intermolecular force of an atom or an ion is going to increase as we go up and to the right on the periodic table. So if I have two species and I want to compare them in terms of their ability to form a stronger intermolecular force, the smaller one is going to be the stronger, and the smaller one is going to be the one that is further up and to the right on my periodic table. And so let's take a look at an example here. So I give you three ionic compounds, so sodium chloride, potassium chloride, and cesium chloride. And I ask you to list them in order of decreasing melting point. So I want to know which one's got the highest expected melting point and the lowest expected melting point. With this type of question, I got to look for the commonality. So it's really hard to compare ionic intermolecular forces if both of the species are different. So say I had sodium chloride and potassium bromide. Well, that's going to be kind of hard. So typically what they do in these types of questions is they keep one of the ions the same. So inside of here, in all three of these compounds, the Cl- is the same. So really what is different is the cation. So when I break these up, it's going to form a positively charged species and a negatively charged species. For all three of these, the negatively charged species is chlorine. So really what I'm going to be looking at is the ionic radius of the cation in this case. So these are all group one metals. Sodium is at the top of the periodic table. Potassium's below that and cesium's below that. So the ionic radius of the cations, sodium is the smallest and cesium is the largest. So remember, as we go up the periodic table, the ionic radius tends to decrease. And so of these three, because sodium is the smallest or has the smallest ionic radius, sodium is going to be able to form the strongest intermolecular force. So of these three species, sodium is going to form the strongest ionic intermolecular force. So sodium chloride, I expect to have the highest melting point, then potassium chloride, then cesium chloride. So this actually, you come to find out if you look up these numbers, it actually adds up. So sodium chloride has a melting point of 801, potassium chloride 770, and cesium chloride 646.